Welcome to another edition of City and State TV. I'm Gerson Borrero, and today we're joined by Angelo Falcón, Angelo to a lot of people. I call him Angelo just to bug him. But anyway, he is a political scientist, a researcher, a guerrilla researcher, and I do want to thank Angelo for coming out because this guy is like a recluse. He's in hiding. All he does is mess around with data. He's been doing it for the past 35 years. And I think you hold the record in terms of Latinos who actually do this type of research on government at the state, city, and federal level. A disclosure for our viewers, and I know Angelo for at least 30 of those years. We worked a lot on some projects, so the disclosure is that I used to be very much involved with the Institute for Puerto Rican Policy. I say that because I know his work. I know that he sometimes is excessive in the way that he actually writes some of these things and says these things. I was part of that also, having been involved in those studies for a long time. I benefit by reading them. So I want to start off right now because City and State, you have a accumulated mass amount of data that started with the government under another Cuomo, that being Mario Cuomo, instead of with regards to civil service and Latinos within the state employment. You've covered administrations at the municipal level for various mayors, starting with Ed Koch and currently de Blasio. So I want to get you straight into Mayor de Blasio because you've done all kinds of stuff here. Put us up to date. What is Mayor de Blasio, this liberal progressive who came in to, with a message of inclusion, eliminating the Tale of Two, or trying to correct the Tale of Two Cities? Where is the de Blasio administration after its first year in office in charge of the New York City government with regards to Latinos and representation of our community within the municipality?
Well, you know, he was elected. There was high expectations that he would be dealing with the issue of the exclusion of Latinos from city any significant role in city government. For like last 20 years under Giuliani and Bloomberg, Latinos were basically on the sidelines. And that's had a tremendous impact on the community negatively in terms of economic development, in terms of leadership development, in terms of how services are reaching our community. And when de Blasio got elected, I said, this is great. A lot of Latinos are saying this is going to be a change. It's going to bring us in. So when he first got elected, I started looking at who he was bringing into his administration from the point of view of, you know, when a new mayor comes in, that person tries to redefine who the leadership is in any, in the city. So I was interested in seeing which Latinos he was going to be identifying as key leaders. So I looked at who he had appointed to his transition team and to his inauguration committee. These are largely symbolic, bodies. And I was...
Well, if they're symbolic, why are you looking at them?
Well, because he begins to identify key people who he considers to be key people in different communities that he wants to bring in.
In redefining who the new leadership is under. Okay.
So as I'm looking at that issue, I noticed something funny, and that is that the Latinos in the transition team, the number of Latinos, and even in the inauguration committee, which is even more symbolic, ceremonial, was Latinos were very underrepresented. It was a very small number. I compared in the transition team the number of Latinos, the percentage of Latinos that were on the transition teams of Bloomberg, Koch, and Giuliani. I found that on the Bloomberg and Giuliani, they had a higher percentage of Latinos on the transition team. So it didn't click. It didn't make sense in terms of, wait a minute, this is a progressive administration. I thought we're going to be bringing Latinos in. And in these two committees, Latinos were underrepresented.
So how does he fare with David Dinkins? Because you could say that out of all that you mentioned, Dinkins is more similar to him. As a matter of fact, he got his, he earned his stripes or started to anyway with David Dinkins. So how does he compare with that?
Well, Dinkins also did not have a really good track record in bringing in Latinos. In fact, contrary to the urban legend of the, the gorgeous mosaic, Latinos are very dissatisfied with the Dinkins administration, right, and very hostile towards it, especially towards the end. So what you have is a situation where I start looking at who he starts appointing, in his first year in office.
That being Bill de Blasio.
And the beginning was very interesting because at the beginning in January of last year, about 26% of his appointments were of Latinos. I said, well, that's tremendous. That's Carmen Fariña, Lillian Barrios Paoli, Gladys Carrion. But then as we looked at it, up until about last month, that percentage went down to 11%. Now, Latinos are 29% of the city's population.
Right.
And so this makes Latinos the most underrepresented group, even in terms of appointments, even compared to blacks and Asians. So there's a problem there. So I've been documenting this from the beginning. And one of the things that happens, we briefed the Latino community about what was going on.
Right.
And that resulted in a bunch of Latino groups getting together and forming the Campaign for Fair Latino Representation. That has been, for example, trying to get a meeting with the mayor, something as simple as getting a meeting with the mayor to talk about this issue and to raise you know, consciousness in the community about this.
But the figures that they're using, the data and the studies, is basically what you've done through the National Institute of Latino Policy,
yeah.
NILP. So basically, what is your role right now? Is NILP part of, or are you, what capacity do you hold within this group? Are you part of it? I know that you've been harping on meeting, and I'm going to try to explain your obsession with meeting with mayors. But go ahead with regards.
Well, you know, we basically are technical advisors to the group. It's a citywide coalition of activists from different parts of the city. Mm-hmm. We are technical advisors. We provide them with, you know, data that we get updating
right.
the numbers and all their information. You know, basically our feeling is that we want to meet with the mayor because in any discussion about diversity of employment, one rule is that the person on top, whether it's a corporation, the CEO of a corporation, the head of a government, has to have give the commitment to it. Otherwise, you're really not going to have the diversity within that organization. So the meeting with the mayor is symbolic to a certain degree, but also it's a way of saying that New York City really understands that this is a problem that the mayor directly says has to be addressed. And we don't have that kind of commitment.
Well, all the mayors that you've dealt with, that you actually, you know, analyze their administrations, the lack of Latinos, whether directly in the municipal or the civil service part of it, or the direct appointments they make, who's been the worst and who's been the most receptive? Who's really tried to do something, not only in performance and actually appointing people and getting Latinos in, and who's actually just paid a lip service? And I'm talking from Ed Koch, David Dinkins, Rudolph Giuliani, Michael Bloomberg, and of course, Bill de Blasio, who's still, the jury's still out there.
Well, of those, though, the one that ironically engaged us the most was Ed Koch. Ed Koch, yes. Which a lot of people saw as being very racially divisive, was someone we didn't agree on a lot, but we actually were engaged. He set up an advisory committee on Hispanic affairs in response to the issues that we've been raising.
I think he was the first one to actually do that.
In terms specifically on Hispanics. And then when you get into Giuliani and you get into Bloomberg, well, that's off the table. They're really an attempt not to really deal with our community in any serious way. So that's it. And even with the Dinkins administration, where, again, there were high hopes, even in that administration, towards the end, the feeling was that he wasn't being responsive to this community as well.
David Dinkins, I think, garnered at least, if I'm not mistaken, close to 90% of the Latino vote at that point, which in both elections, I think was composed mainly of Puerto Ricans.
Right.
I know that Bill de Blasio, because the numbers are fresher right now, I'm not looking at any notes, he actually got 87% of the Latino vote in the 2013 election. Those are the two people that we can say, David Dinkins, elected with a huge amount of Latino support, Puerto Rican support. The same with Bill de Blasio. Is there no respect? Are we like the stepchildren in this gorgeous mosaic that David Dinkins?
I think one of the problems we have, and it's really come to light in this administration, is that the Latino elected officials who should be at the leadership of supporting these issues, raising these issues, have been terrible. I mean, they've been really mediocre. They've been a lot of them corrupt. Today, for example, as we raise this issue, which to me is a black and white issue of the lack of Latino appointments,
right.
how low they are. I mean, to me, it's a no-brainer. It's a problem. The administration should be dealing with it, period. even if it's just for their own political advantage. We find that the Latino city council people, including Melissa Mark-Viveríto, the speaker, have been supporting the mayor and not the community. So they've come out basically saying that the mayor is doing the right thing, even though the numbers really point in another direction. Part of the problem we have now is that the role of the city council is such that it's so connected to the mayor's agenda that there really is no opposition, and the mayor basically has a lot of control over the political kind of objectives, the political rhetoric, and even the way they talk about the some issues. So even though we have a new crop of Latino city council people, they're all basically not supporting the community on this issue, but basically are in line with the mayor. And that's very unhealthy for the city.
But Angelo, I'm sitting here, and to the viewers, I have the background. I know some of this stuff. I was even there one of the meetings where Koch that he threw, well, he threw you out of his office, and I was there. He threw around four or five of us that we went to meet with him. He just got sick and tired, and he threw us, literally, physically threw us out, called the security and everything. John Lo Cicero, who was a top aide advisor to him, who he's, I see him once in a while, John Lo Cicero can vouch that he just threw us out of the office. And he thought you were crazy. But having said that, you weren't disrespectful, you just presented them as, but now you're telling me something. Are you telling me that our leadership is so lacking that taking from Latino, Puerto Rican elected officials, starting there was a majority at that point when when Ed Koch, David Dinkins, and Dennis started going on, that we have such a irresponsible crop of elected officials throughout? What is it that, so it's our own fault is what you're saying? Because if you go from that time, the period of the 80s, coming up to in the late 70s and coming up now into 2015, are you telling me that it's, are we cut by the same scissors? And
well, there's a real leadership vacuum in the Latino community, and it's personified by the people we currently have in the city council, 11 Latinos in the city council, including the speaker. You would think that would give us more leverage as a community. But in fact, what happens is that they're running counter to this issue, for example, of just having more Latinos in city government, making sure that we're at the table. One of the things that people say right away is, what are you complaining about? You have the city council president as a Puerto Rican. So isn't that enough? Well, we know that the city policies or the budget is driven by the executive. We need to have people not just in the city council, but also in the executive branch in policymaking positions.
But some of these council members, I look, they're not here to defend themselves, and I'm certainly not going to become a defender, but they have said that, you know, that give the mayor some time. That's what they were saying, and it's the first year. So they have said that. But you're saying we've given them time before and they haven't produced. Is that what your concern
is? Well, I mean, right now, for example, by giving them time, most major positions have been filled. Latinos are on the outs. We're giving them a lot of time, also much more time than they need to basically find ways to ignore us. I mean, I hear more and more complaints in the Latino community about people going in for interviews to be interview positions and getting the runaround because the administration is not taking our community seriously. The fact that, you know, you go from 26% of the appointments in January being Latino down to 11%. And it keeps going down.
So he started out doing the right thing.
Yeah, it looked that way. Yeah, but it was very temporary and it was very cosmetic. You know, they mentioned, for example, again, what are we complaining about? The one-third of the city's budget is education. So Carmen Fariña is in charge of that. So, you know, but that doesn't deal with other issues, housing, economic development, all those types of issues.
But he also has Lilian Barrios Paoli, and you know she's a seasoned, experienced person who knows government inside out, knows how the city functions. He also has Gladys Carrion also at the with the children's services and with a major overhaul there. You're saying that's not enough.
It's not enough. It's that these people are concentrated in their areas of work. There are a whole bunch of, there are like over 39 agencies that deal with all aspects of people's lives in our community's lives, that many agencies that don't even have hardly any Latinos in there or any kind of Latino consciousness. For example, the worst agency, the Department of Cultural Affairs, a lot of our arts organizations are struggling, and they're having problems because there's absolutely no presence of Latinos.
So that we're clear and our viewers understand what you have in terms, because they read a lot of stuff that you sent out through the NiLP, the National Institute of Latino Policy, and the studies you've done, by the way, that also reflects the exclusion or over-inclusion of certain groups, including you deal with Asians, you deal with Blacks, you have whites in there, and female, the gender thing you do also.
Right.
Are you telling me that what you really are saying, and maybe the mayor hasn't understood this, this current Mayor de Blasio, that you're not really concerned, overly concerned with appointments, but rather the representation throughout the administration?
Sure, sure.
Okay, so it's not a matter of give us another deputy mayor or another commissioner, that would be good.
Right.
But you're saying, at what level would you be, what level do you think would be satisfactory in terms of real representation, so the community is excluded?
I wouldn't even talk about it that way. What we've been doing is proposing to the mayor a process of looking at policies. We're not talking about quotas. We're not talking about this percent. What we're saying is, look, we want the city to make a real effort to reach out to the community. We have a problem with the pipeline in terms of younger people getting into government. There are things that the city government can be doing to encourage younger people to get involved in government, to train college and other people into different positions, to get people at lower levels, to be prepare them to take over agencies. So what we've been doing is not pushing for specific persons or a percentage, but rather to take a look at why the city has been failing to reach out to the Latino community. So we're telling them, look, you need to take a critical look at things like the Equal Employment Opportunity Office.
Right.
You need to look at the Equal Employment Practices Commission, Human Rights Commission, Civil Service Commission. What is it that's going on there? The city's not reaching to Latinos. What kind of programs can be established to reach out to this community and to do it in a way that the city becomes much better at dealing with newer communities as they come in? In other words, we know that the population is going to keep changing in New York over time. The city has to have a situation where it brings in different communities and much more creative. Most of these EEO programs, affirmative action programs, have become bureaucratized. They're very passive. And so there's a need to take a hard look, like the mayor's looking at other agencies.
I'm almost shocked at the fact that you say that you don't have numbers, you don't have that, but this is how the political animal, the beast that is our elected officials in general, I'm not telling the mayor is the only one, they want to know. You come in and talk to them and you harass them and you say you got to do this. Okay, what do you want me to do? And you don't even come up with a figure. So how do you expect the mayor, and if the Latino elected officials aren't doing it, and the speaker isn't doing it, then how is he, where's the guide?
The guide that we use is, for example, Latinos are 27% of the civilian labor force in the city, of people at working. Mm-hmm. The gap between the percentage of Latinos that are in the work for the city and that percentage is such that we estimate that the Latino community is losing out on over $1 billion a year in salaries.
Okay.
On public sector employment. It's a major problem because this is a community that has a high unemployment rate, a high poverty rate, low income, and this kind of, it can't afford not to have that kind of resource going into the community. That's the basis in the black community. That's a model that we use where much of the black middle class is based on public sector employment. That hasn't happened in the Latino community. So there's a lot at stake here.
As we wrap this up, because we have some time constraints here, and of course this goes unedited and you'll be able to come back. I want to bring you back so you can talk about the state government, which you're very well versed on, and I don't think we've made any advances from one Cuomo to the other.
It's actually worse.
It's worse at the state.
Yeah.
So we're going to have you back right here on City and State TV. I ask you to join me again, probably let a few weeks go by. Is there an agency or agencies in which Puerto Ricans, Latinos are really at a level that what you've looked at, the data says, this should be the model? What agencies are, do they exist?
Well, not really. I mean, one of the things that's interesting is that the city agencies are very segregated. There are some agencies that are predominantly black in employment.
Like which ones?
The Administration for Children's Services.
Where Gladys Carrion is the commissioner.
Is like 62% of black employees.
Okay.
We have the Human Resources Administration also. And then the rest of the agencies. One of the things about the appointments, which is really interesting by the administration, is that 61% of the appointments are of white people. Now, whites are about a third of the city's population, but they represent 61% are whites.
Across the board?
In terms of the appointments, yep. And that's the other thing, this disparity, this racial disparity is something that, again, we thought this administration would be addressing. So when they talk about diversity, you have blacks underrepresented, Latinos underrepresented, Asians underrepresented. Latinos underrepresented the worst, and whites overrepresented, almost double their percentage of the population.
You just realize it's a white world. That's yes. What it is. I'm Gerson Borrero for City and State TV. We've been joined today with a very engaging conversation. Sometimes you just put life into it. You got to have you back to talk about the state. But Bill de Blasio, he wants to sit down with you. I don't know what for, because he doesn't even want to give you a deal with you. So, but Angelo, thanks for the work that you do on behalf of the Latino community. We've been doing it for 35 years now. National Institute Latino Policy, Angelo Falcón, researcher extraordinaire with the guerrilla research that a lot of people use and actually get jobs. We'll talk about that some other day. Gerson Borrero for City and State.